up and give you. We give you all the glory for all of the breakthroughs that have happened in this place. We give you all the glory for all the baptisms and lives that have come to you in this place throughout this year. We give you all the glory for all of the healing that has happened in this place. We give you all the glory because you've been good. You've been worthy of all of our praise. And so, God, as we lift you up on this last Sabbath of 2018, we ask for you to pour out your spirit just one more time. Lord, pour out your spirit into all of our hearts and all of our minds. Remove all of the distractions that we may be experiencing right now. And God, we ask for your Holy Spirit to come down like fire. We ask for your Holy Spirit to refine us yet again. We ask for your Holy Spirit to revive us yet again. We ask for your Holy Spirit to move us, oh God. We ask for your Holy Spirit to transform us, oh God. We ask for your Holy Spirit to do what it do best, God, and that's show up and show out, oh God. Lord, transform our hearts, transform our minds, oh God. And when we leave here today, may we, without any shadow of doubt, know that we have been with God, that God has dwelled with us, that God has been in this place, that God has transformed us. Lord, we're asking for you to pour your Spirit out on us, oh God. Lord, you poured your Spirit out in January. You poured your Spirit out in February and in March. You poured your Spirit out in April, God, and in May and in June and July, oh God. You poured it out in August and September and October and November. And now I'm asking you to pour it out yet again in December, oh God. Pour your Spirit out on us, oh God. Pour your Spirit out on us, oh God. Pour your Spirit out on us, oh God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you believe that God's going to pour his Spirit out, why don't you stand with us as we worship God together. Continually be in my mouth. Oh, my soul shall make its boast in the Lord, and the humble shall hear thereof and be glad. Oh, Riverside, won't you magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together, because I believe that God is worthy to be praised together. He's worthy to be magnified. He brought us through danger, seen and unseen. God is worthy to be praised. So let that be our call to worship, that God is worthy to be praised.
Come on, let's sing it together. All hail.
Bring forth.
Put your hands together with us this morning. We
Amen, amen. How many of you know that Jesus will? Yes, he will. Amen. You know, in the marathon, when people are running the race, the marathon, we often notice that at the end of it all, people are stumbling over the line, trying to make it. But I want to say that as Christians, we're not going to be stumbling over the line at the end of this year. We are determined that we're going to run the race. Amen. We're not going to be weak and weary. We are going to be strong in the faith in Jesus Christ, knowing that Jesus will. Whatever you're going through, Jesus will. Amen. Amen. I'm so glad to see so many of you here this morning. We want to praise God for bringing you safely here. You know, sometimes we take for granted the small things. We think that when we got in our car and we turn on the engine and we drove here, that we got here because we were good drivers. But that's not true. We got here because of God's grace. Amen. We're all present, and we just want to welcome all of you, and we want you to be touched by the ministry and the power of His Holy Spirit. Amen. Are you glad to be here this morning? I'm glad that you are here. And we just want to let you know that our mission here at the church is to introduce you to a God, to get to know this God. Amen. We are not interested in playing church here. We're not here because somebody told us to be here. We have come because we want to know God. And we have come because we want to grow in God. And we have come because we want to sow God's love. Amen. Amen. And not only sow God's love, we want to go for God and tell somebody about what God has done for us. Amen. And so we welcome you, and we pray that as you worship with us, that you will be truly blessed. God has been good to us. We've seen another last Sabbath in the year. And we are grateful for that. But there were some among us who were not as fortunate. And recently our church has been experiencing a lot of loss. And yesterday we experienced another one. At 9 a.m., Webby Jamel, one of our beloved members, passed away. I just want you to remember the family. The time like this, Claire and Simon, just asking that you lift them and their families up in prayer so that God can help them through this time of grief. And also, and I didn't get to send this out, but this has been on my heart. Also, Tony's grandmother, Tony Brown's grandmother, passed away. I just want you also to pray for him and his family. Death is not a nice thing. Brings us sorrow and grief. But that's why we have Jesus. For the wages of sin is death. But the gift, you may have had a lot of gifts this Christmas, but there's only one gift that can give you eternal life. And that is Jesus Christ. Amen. And so even though we mourn those who fall asleep in Christ, we do not mourn them as those who have no hope. We shall see them again. Amen. Amen. And so at this time, as our tradition is, we want you to get up off of from your seats, stand up, and we want you to greet each other in Jesus' name. Amen. We went through the holidays. We celebrated with family. But now we are back together. Some of our families have gone back home and left us. But But we are still a family in Jesus Christ. Amen. And so I just need you to stand as we just greet each other in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Say this is a day
that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made.
I will rejoice and be glad. Worthy of a great praise this morning. Can we lift up a great praise to our God this morning and celebrate all that he is to us? Hallelujah. We give your name all the glory and the praise this morning. Hallelujah. Jesus is great. The name of Jesus is mighty. There's nobody like our God. Do you believe that? That there's nobody like our God. There's no God. There's nobody that can hold you in the midnight hour. Nobody that can make ways out of no way. He is the great and mighty God. He is the sovereign God. He is the God that gives us peace. He is the God that gives us joy. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We bless your name, God. A simple song. It says, great and mighty is our God. I want you to think about how great he is in your life, even just this week. Come on and help me say, great and mighty is our God. No matter what the doctor said, no matter what people at your job may have said, God has the final say. Great and mighty is our God. Hallelujah. Come on and help me say, great and mighty is.
Great and mighty is our God.
There's nobody like the Lord. Worship your God in this place this morning. Say, great.
Great and mighty.
He's so great. He's so great. He's so great. He's so great. Come on and say, great and mighty.
Great and mighty.
Hallelujah. We celebrate who you are, Jesus. We celebrate who you are. Say, great and mighty.
Great and mighty is our God.
Come on and declare, there's no.
Sabbath, saints. You know, we often think of God, and you know, we think about how much he loves us, but you know, the Lord is just putting in my spirit that he's a deliverer.
That's right. Yeah,
you know, that no matter what we're struggling with, he can deliver us from it. You know, the whole reason Jesus came to this earth as a baby was to deliver us. That was the whole reason. And so, you know, the Lord helped me to see this week. You know, I was on call on Christmas, before and through Christmas. And we had this patient, you know, not with much education. Nobody, he didn't have a lot of resources. But he came in with, he complained of back pain, but he also had an abscess. He had bacteria in his blood. And so I wasn't the primary doctor. I was the consultant. And the bad part about being the consultant is all you can do is give advice. You can't write orders or anything. So I told him, I said, they fixed the abscess. They took him to surgery, fixed the abscess, and he still had bacteria growing in his blood, and he was not turning around. And so I said to the team, I said, I think he might have an infection in his back. Why don't you get a scan and see if he has an infection in his back? And they didn't do it. So 2 days passed, 3 days passed. Christmas morning, my fellow had already seen him and said, oh, Dr. Drake, he's the same. You know, he just wants pain medicine, so he keeps complaining about this back pain. But we're not going to give it to him. I said, you know what? He might be complaining, trying to get pain medicine, but his labs are not abnormal because he wants pain medicine. I said, look at these labs. Something is going on. So when I went in to examine the patient for myself, he couldn't move his legs. And part of when you have a back infection is it can actually get in your spine. And when it gets in your spine, it affects the nerves. And it's a surgical emergency. So I went to the team. I said, you know, he's not walking. They said, well, when our attending saw him this morning, he was walking. I said, I actually believe that. I believe when your attending saw him, he was walking. He's not walking now. That's what I'm saying. So they were like, well, what should we do? I said, well, I don't operate. You need to get the surgeons in to see him. So to make a long story short, we had to transfer him to Vanderbilt so that he could have surgery. But, you know, as I was talking to the team later about it, you know, this man is not a Christian. We serve a God that blesses people even when they don't serve him. Have you thought about that? I mean, God is not, I don't know what the right word is. God isn't, you rub my back, I rub yours. God loves everybody. And that's a witness to us as Christians. He's merciful even when we don't do right. He shows mercy. So when they got in there, they called me about 4 o'clock because it was a lot of drama getting him to Vanderbilt, getting him in the scanner, getting him to surgery, just a lot of drama. I said, do y'all know how much they pay us? They pay us to make this happen fast. You know what I mean? But they weren't listening. Anyway, when the man got in there, he had an abscess in his back. And he's able to walk now because they were able to relieve the pressure and his nerves are starting to regenerate. But I was thinking, I said, guys, if we had waited a day like they were asking us to, he would have actually been paralyzed in the morning. And even if you decompress him, he wouldn't have ever walked again. And I was thinking, I said, God, this man is not a Christian. I mean, he said it, he bootlegs. He is not a Christian. But God still showed him mercy. Do you know that? I mean, have you thought about how good God is, that he's good to us even when we aren't good to him? And so I want us to just think about, saints, that God loves you even if you don't love yourself. Even if you don't feel like I'm not good enough, God says you are. Because Jesus is the substitute. Sister White says, well, he doesn't see us when we come before the throne. He sees the sinless Savior, Jesus Christ. And so, saints, I want y'all, as we bow before, don't feel guilty. Just think about that God had mercy on somebody that didn't serve him and probably ain't going to serve him, even though he can walk now. God had mercy on this man. He'll have mercy on us. He says to come boldly to the throne of grace. Come like you belong there. I watched Cameron and Miles walking through Vanderbilt. They act like they belong there. And you know why they walk like that? Because they do. Their mama owns that spot. That little spot that's mine is mine. And so they walk through that spot like they belong there. We should come before God like we belong there. Because Jesus has made sure we do. So let's have a word of prayer. So I ask you to get in whatever position is comfortable for you. Father God, sir, I just want to thank you and bless you and magnify you because you are amazing. God, your heart is so full of love that even when we don't do right, you do do right. You don't say, if you come to church, if you read your Bible, if you do such and such, I will do such and such. Oh, no, God. Oh, no. That's not the type of God you are. You are a God that loves to bless. It makes you happy to bless us, to help us. And God, even though that man didn't thank you that he can walk, I want to thank you. I want to thank you for helping me to see it. I want to thank you for me calling the right people. I want to thank you, God, that people were willing to come in on Christmas Day because you wanted to save this man's life. And I thank you for that. I bless you, God. And so, Lord, as we watch Webby resting in you, God, make your spirit be with Claire and Simon. Lord, bless them to realize that this is just a rest. He's just resting. When Jesus comes back, Webby will be one of the first to get up, because it says the dead in Christ will rise first. And then, Lord God, the same thing with Tony's grandmother. Lord, as I look at Tony's life and how he's worked, Lord, for the church and for the children of our church, God, she will look back and say, Tony, did you make it too? And Lord God, there will be a praise in God's kingdom. So I thank you for that. Lord, help us blow away this deception that you only love us when we're good, that you only love us when we come to church, that you only love us when we read our Bibles. You love us because we're your children, and I thank you for that. May we reciprocate that love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
There was a holy hush all over as I walked towards the Lamb. As I stood before him face to face, I was gloriously made new. There was a great and awesome presence and a light bright as the day. As I bowed to kneel with the angels, I heard the Spirit say, arise, arise, and stand before the throne of God in the presence of the Holy One. Arise, arise, as we worship the Messiah. As I looked at those all around me with their hands uplifted high, the Spirit laid his hands on me and I uplifted mine, and we were singing hallelujahs, praises to his name. As I bowed to kneel with the angels, I heard the Spirit say, stand before the throne of God in the presence of the Holy One. Arise, arise, as we worship the Messiah, singing, holy, 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 worthy is the Lamb who was and is to come. He is the great High. Stand before the throne of God in the presence of the Holy One.
You didn't get that one. You need to check your pulse. What a way to end the year. Think about the second coming of Christ and the resurrection of those who've died in Christ and soon return. That's what we hear about, right? Seventh day Adventist. The Advent, return of our Lord, the second Advent. Praise his name. It was our first time with the ministers group in our new town, my associate pastor and I. It was an interdenominational group, and we were the only Adventists. We went around the circle, each one introducing himself. And I must admit, I was surprised when my associate pastor's turn came, and he started with an apology. He apologized for the whole Adventist church. He apologized for the times that we may have offended other churches and made them feel inferior to us. Thinking to myself, what in the world is he doing? What's he doing? But then I noticed the reaction of the other ministers. They suddenly got still. They listened intently. And when he was done, they thanked him for his apology. They were too gracious to say and give examples of our arrogance, but they simply said, "We appreciate you saying that." And I was stunned. But my associate knew. Someone in the house of God today is going to be offended by this word. It's the kind of sermon some people disagree with, and when they do, they try to discredit the sermon or discredit the preacher, usually by misrepresenting what was said. So I must stay especially close to the scriptures today. If this is my word, we can debate it, but if it's God's word, we debate at our peril. Because God does not debate. God declares. God commands. We listen. We learn. We obey. That's God's way. I challenge us today to hear God's word with open minds under this title, Is Jesus a Seventh-day Adventist? Let's pray. Father, we come to the last Sabbath of this year. We want it to mean something. We have this opportunity here in your house, listening online, hearing later by whatever means. As we have this opportunity, Lord, help us not to let it go by, but to use this chance to make our peace with God through surrender, through repentance. So you can have your way in our lives. We can close out this year with sound minds, with peace of mind, hopeful for the future, thankful for your grace, sharing your grace with others. Lord, that's our prayer. Turn it over to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Before I start, let me apologize to you today because we won't be at the door as usual. My wife and I have a trip to make. We're going to leave right after service. Our last Sabbath especially, it's going to seem kind of rude, but I'm sorry. We really don't have a choice. So we'll miss you. So we'll say thank you now for your graciousness to us over these months. Thank you for receiving us so well. Thank you to the pastor and the pastoral team especially for being so kind and accommodating. A couple of times these last few months, I had a last-minute change in my schedule, and I just pulled out once on Wednesday. Pastor had to juggle that thing and fix it up by Sabbath, and he did so. I'm thankful for that. I want to say welcome back to Pastor Fordham next Sabbath for the new year. returning, refreshed, rejuvenated, ready to take his part. I know you're going to be glad to see him, and you're going to let him know so. I know he'll be glad to return to you. Let's begin today with Mark chapter 9, verses 33 to 37. For God's word today is Jesus, a Seventh-day Adventist. They came to Capernaum. When he was in the house, he asked them, "What were you arguing about on the road?" They kept quiet because on the way they had argued about who was the greatest. Sitting down, Jesus called the 12 and said, "If anyone wants to be first, he must be the very last and the servant of all." He took a little child and had him stand among them. Taking him in his arms, he said to them, "Whoever welcomes one of these little children in my name welcomes me. And whoever welcomes me does not welcome me, but the one who sent me." We are not surprised that they keep quiet when Jesus asks them what they were disputing. He has chastised them many times before concerning their constant infighting. No doubt the disciples would characterize it differently. They would say they were sorting out leadership issues or doing housekeeping. But Jesus sees the "who is the greatest" argument for what it really is: a selfish contention over supremacy. It is the most common dispute among the disciples, usually provoked by Judas. It's an indication of their spiritual immaturity and their lack of conversion, a sign, even though they loved Jesus and followed him, the old nature was still in charge. So Jesus speaks to them, calling on a little child, and instructs them once again on the true nature of his kingdom, what it is and what it is not. "In order to be first," Jesus said, "you must be the very last." To be first, you have to be last. It's a radical reversal of the human value system. For us, leadership means the top of the heap, not the bottom. First is always better than last. We associate first with greater knowledge, more talent, higher status, more notoriety. I want us to notice something. Jesus does not condemn the disciples for aspiring to be leaders in his kingdom. He doesn't tell them that their ambition is evil. In fact, they will all become leaders in his kingdom, but it will not be what they think. The Bible calls the desire for leadership a good thing. Whoever aspires to be an overseer, the Bible says, desires a noble task. The King James says, desireth a good work. Jesus commends the noble desire to be a servant leader in his kingdom, so long as we understand what we're getting into. It will not be what we think. Kingdom of God, leadership is a privilege, but not a right. It's by divine appointment, not by human politics. And it is always, always a call to suffering. It is founded on humility, not supremacy. On service, not entitlement. On sacrifice, not on fame. The only greatness that God recognizes is the greatness of humility. It was the last and hardest lesson for the disciples to learn. Then in Mark 9, the story takes an interesting turn. As he listens to his Lord's teaching, John is suddenly conscience-stricken. He recalls a recent incident in which he played a part. At the time, he thought he was doing the right thing, acting honorably, defending the integrity of the church. But now, John has cause to question his motive. He suspects something nefarious may have been at work in him. With the openness of a child, he confesses it to Jesus. Teacher, we saw a man driving out demons in your name, and we told him to stop because he was not one of us. The disciples come upon a man, some back road or some valley, performing feats of demon deliverance. The people are flocking to him in droves. They're bringing their afflicted ones, men, women, and children. Some of them have been muttering senselessly. Some have been completely mute. Others have been roaming the streets at night with wild eyes, unable to sleep. They're all brought to this nameless preacher. He raises his hands and speaks words of deliverance in the name of Jesus. The demons try to hold on to their prey, but they can't resist that name. They must come out. So the captives are set free. The mute regain their speech and the lunatics their sanity. The people are rejoicing, giving glory to God along with holy angels. It's a magnificent scene. But when the disciples show up and see what's going on, this anonymous man invoking the name of their Lord, they put a stop to it. They've never seen him before. He's not from their group. For all they know, he hasn't even been baptized. They shut down the independent church. They disperse the renegade congregation. They chastise the rogue minister and send him packing. And the miracle of casting out demons is aborted. The praise of God is muted, and the people are left in bondage. And what is the rationale? Simply this: the preacher was not one of them. They had not authorized him. He did not carry credentials from their organization. He was practicing ministry without a license. Never mind the people who were being delivered. Their leadership was under threat. They had to defend themselves. They had to defend the name of their Lord. At least that's what they told themselves. I want us to notice what the unnamed preacher was not doing. He was not preaching against Christ. He was not organizing a rival group. He was not taking people's money for his personal gain. He was not teaching false doctrine or using the Lord's name in vain. In fact, he was doing the very work Christ announced he had come to earth to do, to free the captives. And the question becomes, if in spite of all this, the disciples saw him as not one of them, then who are they? As we look at their behavior and try to learn from it, we realize one of the underlying issues is the disciples have an identity crisis. Don't know who they are. A disciple is a follower or student of a teacher. The idea was that in order to truly learn, one had to practice their discipline, not just read about it. One had to be with the teacher. Learn from him directly, not just from his writings, but by his daily life. And first century Palestine was a discipleship culture. There were many discipleship leaders, not just Jesus. Some of them would pitch tents along the way and have little lessons with their followers. As for the 12, they've been with Jesus some time now. They've followed him everywhere. They've observed his life. They've listened to his teachings. They've learned from his parables. They've made sacrifices to follow him. They gave up their livelihoods and their families. James and John left their fishing business. Matthew got straight up and walked out of his tax office. The other disciples too, the Bible says, left everything to follow him. But with all that, there is still something lacking with them. They are like Jesus outwardly, but they're not with him inwardly. They don't fully understand Jesus yet. They think he's like them. And they don't fully understand themselves yet either. They think they are like him. A crisis of identity. This situation, they do the opposite of what their Lord would have done. They don't know who they are. They have confused identity. And their identity confusion undermines mission, as it always does. It's a principle for us. We can't do what we're called to do if we're not being what we're meant to be. Identity affects mission. There's an identity crisis in the Adventist church. Have we forgotten who we are? Since 1984, the Bonner Research Institute has been compiling statistics on comparative religious practice in the United States. One of their studies some years ago revealed something disturbing about our church. Members from 12 congregations were polled concerning their prayer habits. The question was, have you prayed to God in the past 7 days? The highest percentage of yes answers came from the Pentecostals. 97% said they prayed to God this week. The national average for all adult Christians was 82%. Adventists, only 79%. Lower than the national average. If you think 79 is not so bad, think of it this way. In the past 7 days, one out of every 5 Adventists went an entire week without talking to God. I'm talking now about identity crisis. Not knowing who we are. The early Advent movement, prayer was literally the lifeblood of the church. The Adventist pioneers relied on prayer more than anything else. We would come together, servant of God says, burdened in soul, praying that we might be one in faith and doctrine, for we knew that Christ was not divided. Hallelujah. Earnest supplications went up to heaven that God would help us to see eye to eye, that we might be one as Christ and the Father are one. Many tears were shed. We spent many hours this way. Now, I don't know about you. To be honest with me, that does not sound like the Adventist church today. Sabbath of the year, let's be real. That doesn't describe our church today. I'm talking about identity crisis. I want us to notice not only the activity of prayer itself, but the subject of their prayers. The early Adventists did not pray that they would be the best church, or the biggest church, or the most wealthy church. They prayed that they would be one as Christ and the Father are one. Do we pray like this anymore? Think about it. What do we pray for, and what does it say about our identity as a people that we pray for those particular things? What do we pray for when we get together? We're in the habit, some of us, of thinking as Adventism as who we are rather than as what defining what we do. Stay with me now, church. Hear me now. I'm speaking now about the distinction between mission and identity. Seventh-day Adventist is a name that reminds us of our mission, what we are called to do. And the early Adventists always saw the distinction of mission in terms of this last day message. We have been set in the world, they said, as watchmen and light bearers, given a most solemn work, a work of import, the proclamation of the first, second, and third angel's message. The distinction of Adventism, a mission, a particular mission. When the final warning of the Bible message of prophecy came into its own, God raised up a people to proclaim that specific message. Adventist church wasn't raised up during the Protestant Reformation in Europe. It came up later in the United States. In the time of God's design for a specific message. It's a warning message. A warning to the world. A message of reform to the church. There are no more dispensations. There are no more testaments. There is no more time. Jesus is coming soon. The pre-Advent judgment has already begun. Time is running out. The Adventist mission I'm talking about. This was to be our mission, our focus, as a Christian church of the last days. This church was raised up for the end time. And in the early Advent movement, they felt the burden of this responsibility. That's what drove them to their knees. Get this one. Our numbers were few and mostly from the poorer classes. Our views were almost unknown to the world. We had no houses of worship, but few publications and very limited facilities but carrying forward our work. The sheep were scattered in highways and byways, in cities, in towns, in forests. The commandments of God and the faith of Jesus was our message. It wasn't even a church yet, it was a movement. It was built on primitive godliness. We knew what we were about because we had little of this world's goods and few distractions from our mission. The Adventist church was not a middle-class church. It was a church without, not a church with. Our dependence was on God in full because we had no earthly resources on which to depend. And there was a clarity of mission and a singleness of purpose. But now, mission has been compromised because we have become engrossed in worldly pursuits. Not evil pursuits, just earthbound. No longer a movement, we've turned into an institution. We have investments to watch over, foundations to administer, legal matters to negotiate, copyrights to defend. We have meetings to attend and political schemes to activate. And no time to pray. Here is the classic way to lose touch with Jesus, to forget who we are, is by getting caught up in these things and having no time to pray. Pray. Think about the 12. Now, they were with Jesus, but their hearts were not like his heart. What the 12 did to the man casting out demons is something Jesus would never have done. Look how he answered John in Mark 9, 39 and 40. But Jesus said, "Do not forbid him, for no one who works a miracle in my name can soon afterwards speak evil of me. For whoever is not against us is for us." One more time. Read it with me, church. Read it with me. Whoever is not against us is for us. One more time. Whoever is not against us is for us. Jesus gives them a proverb to correct their hearts and to guide them in the future. In some ways, it's the opposite of what they think. The disciples have an us-them mentality. If they're not with us, they're against us. Christ reverses it. If they're not against us, they're with us. They're insiders, Christ knows, who are still on the outside. They just haven't joined us yet, but their hearts are with us. Jesus has an inclusive theology. There are those out there, Jesus knows, who are under the influence of the Holy Spirit, operating with their faith in him, even though they're not one of the 12, not one of the 70. Christ is telling his men and us that if someone is doing my work in my name, then he's mine, even if you have never laid eyes on him before. You may not know him, but I know him. God told Elijah, there are 7,000 you don't know who have not bowed the knee to Baal. Don't stop him. Pray for him. Something here for us saints, and it's something wonderful, something we need to get a hold of. The Holy Spirit cannot be confined to any one church. Doesn't mean he's not with us, it means he's not with us only. He's at work in places where Adventists are not involved. He's in the far reaches of the earth. His love and power are known among people who don't even know his real name. Your God is too small. There are believers out there who have their hearts right, but they don't have the right classification. May not know the doctrine as well as you do. And while man looks on the outward appearance, the Lord still looks on the heart. We've diminished God. We've made him too small. He wants to be our personal savior, but he will not let us turn him into our private savior. We can't own him. He owns us. There are those on the outside whose hearts are on the inside, and those on the inside whose hearts are on the outside. God reads hearts. He judges by hearts, not by denomination. One of our pastors, Pastor Marshall Ella Brown, one of our pastors told me the story of how he joined the Adventist church. Evangelistic meeting came to his neighborhood. And he went one night. And what he heard just thrilled his soul. So he went and found his running buddy. Invited him the next night. Together they came to the tent. They were street people. They didn't know about church. As they sat under the tent waiting for the service to begin, a church member turned around and said to his friend, "What are you doing coming here smelling like liquor? Don't you know this is the house of God?" Pastor's friend was devastated. He was a sensitive soul. He went outside the tent. He leaned up against a lamppost and just cried like a baby. A sensitive soul. He never came back to the meetings. And 4 months later, he was murdered in the street. That was his last chance. He came in search of something he knew not what, but he was turned away by an Adventist who was not a Christian. We do the opposite of our mission when we don't remember who we are. Adventist describes our mission, but our identity is Christian. Followers of Jesus Christ. If we take refuge in the name Adventist, or remnant, or Sabbath keeper, or vegan, or anything else other than the name of Jesus, we have forgotten who we are. The name Seventh-day Adventist reminds us of our mission, but being an Adventist cannot save us. Our salvation is an identity, and our identity is in Jesus Christ alone. The astronomers say that if you were to stand on the largest beach in the world, the sand disappearing into the horizon on every side, and hold between your fingers a single grain of sand that the size of that grain in proportion to the rest of the beach would be greater than the size of our world in proportion to the rest of the universe. There are billions of galaxies, each having hundreds of billions of stars. And the Bible says God has a name for each star. But then how big is God? And how can we say we belong to God, a God that is so big, if we are small and narrow-minded and bigoted? I wonder if we realize sometimes how much of Adventist heritage was built on the work of God through Christians of other denominations. Hiram Edson honed in the Methodist Church the biblical skills that enabled him to formulate a new interpretation of the sanctuary. Charles Fitch, who designed the prophetic chart that was used to explain Daniel Revelation, he was a Presbyterian minister before joining the Advent movement. William Foy, who received 2 second Advent visions in 1842 and related them to large audiences, he was a Baptist studying for the Episcopal ministry. Joseph Bates developed the spirituality and sensitivity that made him active in the anti-slavery and temperance movements years before there was anything such thing as a Seventh-day Adventist church. And on the day Ellen Harmon became Mrs. Ellen White, neither she nor her husband held membership in any church. Didn't even have a church wedding. They got married as a justice of the peace. You mean to tell me that all those years, God worked through believers from various denominations as he saw fit, and then the day the Adventist church is organized, decided to work from then on only through Adventists? It's okay, it's my last Sabbath here. You don't have to see me anymore. But if you listen with an open heart, you have a chance to grow. We must remember the divine freedom. God is completely free to do whatever he pleases, and the earth is his theater. Jesus Christ came to die for the whole world, and his kingdom is open to whosoever will. That's the word of Scripture, Revelation. Perhaps some of us are too sure of ourselves, too self-sufficient. Do Adventists pray less because we feel the need for prayer less? How can we possibly survive the great test that is soon to burst upon the church and the world with less prayer? We must be willing to learn from the words of Jesus. Whoever is not against us is on our side. Not whoever not against us is neutral. Whoever's not against us is on our side. Right. Desire of Ages 4:38. Every soul whom God has made willing, is a channel through which Christ will reveal his pardoning love. How careful we should be then, lest we discourage one of God's light bearers and thus intercept the rays that he would have to shine to the world. Not every soul whom God has made Adventist, but every soul whom God has made willing. Not might be a channel, but is a channel through whom God will work. Is Jesus a Seventh-day Adventist? It's the wrong question. We don't get to evaluate Jesus. Jesus evaluates us. And we don't get to own him. He owns us. Just as he owns the whole world. The question is not, is Jesus a Seventh-day Adventist? The question is, are Adventists true to Jesus? Or are we only Seventh-day Adventists without Christ? It's not, is Jesus one of us? The question is, are we one of his? Do we belong to Jesus or do we only belong to the church? Here's a soul-searching question for every Christian who belongs to any church. And in some ways, the longer we've been in the church, the more challenging this question is for us to answer. But we must ask it, because when Jesus comes again, he will not be looking for true Adventists. He'll be looking for true disciples. Whatever church they belong to, or if they belong to no church at all. You ever read the Servant of God says that when we're on the cloud ascending to heaven, there'll be believers there who are celebrating their first Sabbath on that cloud going to heaven. I see some of us got tight. You might as well loosen up. Some of us got tight jaws out there. That's okay. You know what? You know what? Think it over. When you go home, think it over. Read the text I shared with you and think it over. Might take a while for you to get it, but open your heart. It's the word of God. Ellen White describes the vision that she received of the coronation of the saints outside the gates of the holy city. The saints are standing on the sea of glass at the gate of the city. And Jesus calls the redeemed by name one by one. The angels hand him the crown, and he places the golden crown on the name of each saint with his own right hand. Jesus does. Some crowns are laden with many stars. Some have only a few stars. But everyone is completely satisfied with his own crown. There's no crown envy in heaven. We better get the envy out of our hearts right now. Envious hearts won't be in heaven. You got to be okay with somebody having a bigger crown than yours. Jesus turns the next direction. He calls the next saint. The ceremony is repeated. The angel, the crown, the harp, the saint, Jesus. What a beautiful progression. I don't know what name he's going to call me by. It won't be Nixon. Nixon's a slave name. I'm going to have a new name coined by him based specifically on my individual character. I don't know what the name is going to be, but when he calls me, I'm going to answer. I'll be somewhere listening for my name. Coronation now reaches a crucial point. All the saints have their crowns, and the last saint now steps up to get his crown. It's Adam, father of the fallen race. He's just a little shorter in height than Jesus is. They're almost eye to eye. And heaven falls silent as Jesus takes the crown of righteousness and places it on the head of the first Adam, through whom all die. From the right hand of the second Adam, through whom all can be made alive. As Adam looks around the number that no man can number, he's overwhelmed. He falls upon the breast of his Redeemer and weeps for joy. And then Jesus throws back the gates of the holy city on its golden hinges, and all the saints of all the ages enter in. And all the redeemed hosts fall down to their knees and cast their crowns at the feet of Jesus. And only one head is crowned now. The head of the Redeemer. And all heaven and all the universe join in songs of praise for him. Servant of God says, the commanding angel strikes a note. And every voice joins in. She says, everybody touches their harp with complete dexterity and with ability. Touches those hearts and sing it. Now, somewhere in that crowd, I'm going to have my voice by the grace of God. And when the angel strikes that note, I'm going to sing out loud. Praise to Jesus. Now, I don't care if I'm in the back of the choir, in the last row where nobody can see me. I don't care. I just want to be there. And here's the good news. I can be there. And so can you. Because the grace of God is free. It's available to every person in whom the breath of God dwells. It's free. It's available. But we have to reach out for it. God won't force it down our throats. We have to reach for it and make it ours. Last Sabbath of the year, here's what I want to challenge you with. Last Sabbath of the year. Simple challenge, everybody can relate to. I want to challenge us now to make a decision of repentance to God on this last Sabbath of the year. Now, I saw the schedule. Correct me if I'm wrong, Pastor. I saw the schedule next Sabbath is the Holy Communion service. Is that right? We start the year with Holy Communion. Do you know the preparation for Holy Communion is? Preparation is reconciliation between the people of God. That's the preparation. We don't come before God with unclean hearts, holding grudges against each other. God can't receive that kind of worship. So here's a chance for us, the last Sabbath of the year, to perform an act of repentance and confession to those we've offended against and to our God. Confession, repentance. But now, hear me now. We can't truly repent if we don't intend to give up our sin. Confession, repentance means surrender. It means I'm giving up everything. I don't know how I'm gonna get, I don't know how I'm gonna do it. Don't know where the strength's gonna come from, but in my mind and in my heart, I'm making a decision right now. I'm sorry, Lord, and I'll never turn back again. That's true repentance. And everybody but Jesus needs repentance. You can't go to heaven without saying, I'm sorry. Nobody does. So here's our big chance, the end of the year, last Sabbath of the year, to make an act of confession and repentance before God. You want to join me? Come here and join me. Let's pray a prayer of repentance together before God. Come here. If you can't come, just stand where you are. If you can't stand, just raise your hand. An act of repentance and confession before God. Don't come if you're not really ready to repent. Repentance doesn't mean you're great. It just means you're sorry. It means you're decided. It means that when 2019 comes in, you're going to be standing with God, not against him. Come to ladies, come closer. Come. You can't come, just stand. If you can't stand, just raise your hand. God will see. Father, I confess my sin. Father, I repent. Lord God, I'm sorry. That's what this call is about. Lord God, I'm sorry. I owe you an apology. I've cast despite on your grace, this call is. I have knowingly disobeyed you. I'm sorry, Lord. That's this call. Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you for getting us here to the end of 2018, last Sabbath of the year. Many, Lord, many of our friends, family, didn't make it this far. But here we are, in your house, on the last Sabbath, with a chance to say, I'm sorry. And we here standing today, we are not letting that chance go by. We've come to our feet. We've come to the altar. We've raised our hands to say, Lord, we've offended against you. Please forgive us. Please cleanse us. Please give us godly sorrow for our sins. Not fake sorrow. Real godly sorrow for our sins. Lord, place it in our hearts. To truly be sorry. To truly confess. And then, Lord, to turn away from sin. All known sin out of our lives, Lord. That's what this stand means for us. Oh, Lord, hear our prayer. Cleanse us by your grace. Strengthen us by the power of your Spirit. Help us to never turn back again. Keep us on the path to which you've guided us, following your Spirit, because one day, Lord, your Spirit's going to lead us right to the gates of heaven. That great coronation service, Lord, we want to be there. We want to be there. Everybody who's not there is going to be stuck down here, waiting for final destruction. Oh, God, let us not be in that number. Oh, God, don't leave here, Lord, without us, we pray. Confess with you. And we thank you for forgiveness, Lord, in Jesus. Said together, amen. Amen.
To thee.
Did your heart not burn within you when you are reminded that don't try to hold God in a box? Don't try to make God, your personal Savior, a private God. You need to understand He's too big to be confined to one denomination, and that He will work with those who are willing to work. Amen. Amen. I just want to share with you, for our offering, a scripture reading. This is a scripture reading that is describing believers before they were called Seventh-day Adventists, describing believers before they were called Baptists or Lutherans or whatever. This is describing believers who received Jesus Christ into their hearts and was acting like Jesus. And it's found in Acts chapter 2 and verse 44. It says, all the believers were together and had everything in common. They sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. And every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Bible says, and the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. Believers recognized that what God had blessed them with was not just for their own enjoyment, their own aggrandizement, but they recognized that what they had was to be used to meet the needs of others who did not have, and to reach others who need to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so this morning, sad to say, are you going to act like Adventists? Or are you going to act and give like true believers in Jesus Christ? The decision is yours. Let's act like believers in Jesus Christ. The deacons will now wait on us for our tithe and offering. Let us all bow our heads as we ask God's blessing on the offering. Father, we thank you for blessing us and giving us an opportunity to bless others. And so, God, as those offerings were collected, I pray, God, that they will use for your glory to reach somebody, to let them know that Jesus loves them and that he's coming soon. So, Father, take control of everything that has been collected and may we use for your glory, is my prayer in Jesus' name. Let the church say, amen, amen, amen. We are now winding down our service today. I just want to tell you that I am pumped. I had a good sermon today, amen. And I'm excited about what God will do through you as you turn your heart over to Jesus Christ. Many of you stood and say, Lord, I'm sorry, I haven't been what I should have been. I want you to note that God has noted what you did today, and he is going to anoint you with his Holy Spirit, and he's going to guide and lead you for the rest of this year and the coming new year. Amen. Aren't you happy? Amen. Amen. We don't have any birthdays today, but I just want to say those who are having birthdays tomorrow and then Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, throughout the week, we are praying for you. You are duly noted. But most of all, God knows your birthday. He brought you in on that day, and he's going to take care of you for the rest of your life. Amen? Amen. Amen. I want to tell you, let me say this. The demographics of the Seventh-day Adventist Church is that the average age is around 58. Right? We're getting to be a kind of an old kind of church, right? Although, you know, I don't consider 58 old. Amen? But we at Riverside are uniquely blessed. We have a new generation of young preachers and leaders that are here in this church. And I want to tell you that they are going to lead us out in bringing in the new year. Amen? And that's going to be happening this coming Monday at 6 p.m. And I'm going to invite one of our new generation leaders to come up and just say a few words of what he has planned for you. Okay? So here's what I don't want to happen. I don't want them to plan and to lead and to make this great program, and then you just stay home. All right? I want you to come and support our young people as they lead us into the new year. Amen? Now, you don't seem too enthusiastic. You don't. Well, let me not say any more. So Greg, come on up and tell the folk what is happening, and it's starting at 6 p.m. on Monday.
Thank you, Pastor. Has God not been good to us this year? Has God not been good to us this year? Amen. And so on Monday at 6 p.m. in the fellowship hall, we are going to be celebrating all that God has done for us. Amen? Amen? Amen. We did not just survive this past year. We thrived, right? And I believe that prophetically God wants this church, our families, individuals to thrive on this upcoming year. So on Monday evening at 6 p.m., we're going to get together and we're going to celebrate God. We're going to lift God up in music, through testimonies, through preaching. Minister Damaris Miller, Minister Eric Holden, and myself, we will be preaching and as sort of a preach-off type ordeal, really celebrating God and lifting up God for what he's done for us this past year, what he's doing for us right now, and what he's about to do in 2019. Amen? And following our service, we're going to have our annual family fun night where we're going to have games and food and fellowship for every member of our church, not just for our kids. right? But for our adults as well, right? We have things planned for our kids, things planned for us as adults. But really, we just want to celebrate God all together. And when midnight hits at on Monday evening, we're going to have some Martinellis. Come on, say amen. And we're going to pop some bottles of Martinelli, and we're going to have some champagne, some Adventist champagne, and we're going to celebrate God on this Monday. So that's the plan. I pray and I hope to see all of you all here. Amen. And let us, and to one point, this is not just for us alone, because God did not just bring us through this year. He brought our community through. He brought our friends through. He brought our family through. So please invite someone who's never been to Riverside so we can celebrate the new year with them. So Monday at 6 p.m., I hope to see you all there. Thank you.
All right. I know I plan to be there. I don't know if I can last to 12 o'clock, though. You know, just kidding. One of the reasons that I am pumped and excited is that next Sabbath, our senior pastor is going to be back. Amen? Amen, 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 amen. And we're going to be having communion, right? And we want all of you to come back next week. We're going to be celebrating his return. He's going to take the mantle off of my shoulders, and they're going to put it back on his shoulders, and you don't have to call me anymore. And all these nice things are going to be happening. So I am pumped for next year. All right, I'll just be in the background picking up things and doing what I need to do and what I'm called to do. But he is going to be back, and we are planning something great and wonderful for you next Sabbath. So please be here. We will have a fellowship dinner, and lots of stuff will be going on. We'd actually also be ordaining three elders that have been chosen by the church and approved by the business meeting. There is a lot of stuff that's going to be happening, but most of all, at 12 o'clock, when that clock hits 12:01, your senior pastor, Pastor Furman Fordham, you can call him anytime you want. Amen, amen, and amen. We want to let you know also that we have our small groups who will be meeting after service. But I also want you to let you know we are going to be doing a church-wide study, but that will not happen until the third Sabbath in January. This world church-wide study, you will hear more about it. We spoke to the Grow Group leaders. But that will not be starting immediately, but will be starting on the third Sabbath of January, just to let you know. So if you want to study the Word of God, just remember we have small groups that are meeting. You can check your little bulletins to see where they are meeting. And we pray that you will truly be blessed and God will continue to guide and direct you as you follow his lead for the new year. At this time, we shall have our closing hymn, followed by benediction. So we invite you to stand as we...
Amen. Our closing hymn will be "Pass Me Not, O Gentle Savior," page 569 in your hymn books. Come on, say, pass me not.
Do not pass me by.
Benediction. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of His Holy Spirit be with you now and forevermore. Let the church say, Amen. Greet somebody in Jesus' name and tell them something that the sermon touched your heart about today.